Good evening and welcome back to Poe Discussions. I am Karma Bolden.
And I'm Jeannie Smith.
And we are...
The Poe-tastic
Two. We got that very well that time. Yeah. Well, we have a special guest this evening, and his name is Stephen Demchuk. And Stephen, welcome, and please tell us a little bit about yourself.
Hi. Well, thank you for having me.
Yes.
I am the founder of Raven Beer, which I started in Europe, in Germany. And it started because I tried to build a brewery in Belgium. And after 2 years of work and disappointments, it never happened. So what little money I had, I started the first Beer of the Month club in Europe called Beer Around the World. Cool. And a supplier of one of our beers, which we focused on small, out of the way, out of Europe for the most part, brands of beer, Wolfgang Stark out of Hamburg, he came to me and said, would you like to brew beer in Germany? And I said, yes. And he said, well, I got an idea to market beer using an American theme, because young Germans are traveling around the world, they're coming back, they don't want to drink the Rheinhutzgebot purity beer and all that. He said, what do you suggest we call the first product? I said, the Raven. He said, the Raven, why the Raven? I said, I'm from Baltimore, Poe was buried in Baltimore, I'm a huge Poe fan. He goes, fantastic, everyone in Europe knows Edgar Allan Poe. Our first beer will be the Raven. Awesome. And that's how it started. And so we brewed our beer in Germany, and a year later I moved to Baltimore and brought the brand to Baltimore, and we still brew in both locations.
Oh, that is fantastic. That is fantastic. And so what year did you guys start Raven Beer?
97 over there and 1998 over here.
Okay. Oh, that is amazing. That is awesome. Mm-hmm. And I have been able to try several of the beers, and they are wonderful. And I don't know if you can see, but I've got the Raven Beer cap, bottle cap earrings, and brought out the, I don't know, it's going to be a little bit.
Pilsner glass. They're from Germany.
Oh, okay, cool. We bought it. My husband and I bought it at the Poe Fest, and he's actually got a Raven Beer shirt too. And so, yeah. So, well, tell us a little bit about the different styles of beer that make up the Raven beers.
Well, the Raven, the first beer is still our flagship beer, the lager, Raven Special Lager. It's quite a smooth, easy drinking beer. Just a real nice Märzen type of beer. It's a rich golden color, 5.2%. We produce Pendulum Pilsner. All of our beers have a tagline. Pendulum Pilsner is a cut above the rest.
Nice. Love it.
Yeah, Telltale Heart, the beating of the heart is, it never skips a beat. So we have the Pendulum Pilsner, a beer named for the Pitna Pendulum. Mm-hmm. And that's 4.5%. We have a 7.3 Telltale Heart IPA, an American IPA. It's really malt based. It's not real hoppy. It's very drinkable.
Nice.
And then comes the cask, our double bock, 8% double bock. That double bock is good as any double bock in the world. It's fabulous. We came out with Annabelle Lee, which is a Belgian wit, named after the poem Annabelle Lee, Poe's last poem, apparently. And that's interesting because on the six pack, we have two stanzas on the side cover of the poem. And, and Annabelle, drawn on the cover, points to the underside. So if you flip the six pack over, you got the rest of the poem written on the bottom.
Oh, that is awesome.
So that might be the first brewery ever to have a complete poem written on a six pack.
Yeah, that is really cool and very creative the way you did that.
Thank you. And then that's a 4.5% Belgian wit, not crazy bitter or hoppy or anything like that. Real traditional Belgium style beer with orange peel and coriander as spices.
Oh, nice.
And we have the Dark Usher, which is a dark Kolsch. The reason for that is Roderick Usher is pretty much a pretty insane dark character. He lives in the dark, stays in the thought, and the curtains are drawn in the house. And I asked our brewer, Ernie, if we could make a Kolsch dark as a stout, but still tastes like a Kolsch.
Oh,
and he came out really spot on.
Okay.
The tagline of that beer is insanely good.
Nice. Love it.
Roderick Usher was insane.
Yes.
So what are we missing? We're missing, Madhouse Oyster Stout, made with Chesapeake Bay oysters. Mm-hmm. After the stout is brewed in the boil in the whirlpool, one oyster per gallon is added, so there's like a full bushel of oysters, shells and all, in tea bags, large tea bags, like pillowcases, dropped in to the whirlpool at 95 degrees centigrade, nearly boiling. Stays in there for 15 minutes, and then they're attached to ropes, like large tea bags, and we pull them out.
Gotcha, okay.
So that gives saltiness to the beer, and then we eat the oysters afterwards. They're black and stout. But
wow.
and that's Madhouse Oyster Stout. That's based after the Imp and the Perverse.
Oh, yes.
And we have a imp hanging from the word stout or madhouse. And the oysters are from Madhouse Oysters. Out of Fishing Creek, Maryland.
Okay.
So that's why we call it Madhouse Oyster Stout. Of course, the character in Poe's story is in an insane asylum, in a madhouse. Mm-hmm. So it all fits together.
That's a nice tie-in, absolutely.
Yeah. Hold on, I think can you see?
Yes.
See Poe sitting in a oyster shell drinking a beer.
That, oh, I love that. That is really cool.
And our last beer, we have a DIPA, a double IPA at 8%. Mm-hmm. Cloudy beer. It's like the Telltale Heart, very smooth, a little bit more alcohol, cloudy. And our final beer we just released is Lenore, Belgian wit like the Annabelle Lee, but with raspberries in it.
Oh, that would be really good. Yeah. Oh, wow. Okay. Will you have that one available during October when the Poe Fest is going to be going on?
We're not sure. We may wait. It may just be a summer beer.
Okay. That makes sense too, when they're normally raspberries are in season. So.
Are you coming to the festival?
Yes. And we will have a vendor booth this year. So
if I can find a can, I'll make sure I'll keep it for you.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you. And
you're having the vendor booth. Good.
Yeah. And we love coming. Jeannie is not sure if she's going to be able to come or not, but my husband and I will be there, and we're trying to get Jeannie there. So
it's on my list.
Yeah. Will you guys have a booth selling the Raven beer?
Well, we have a beer garden.
Okay. That's what I thought. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Like last year. We'll do that again this year.
Great. Okay. That is awesome. Now, can you do tours of like the facilities? Like some of the breweries have tours and things like that.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's possible.
Okay. Oh, very cool. Very cool. This is good for all of our listeners and viewers to hear about this. Mm-hmm. And I wish Raven Beer could be bought down in Tennessee, but So. Jeannie, what questions do you have?
How many brewers do you actually have on staff that are working to, and how many ideas, I guess, do you have working at the moment for future beers?
Oh, the ideas are endless. Those characters and stories seem to be endless. Thinking about doing Eureka next, something based on science of his story, Eureka, his novella.
Yeah.
So we have, you know, I do the creation of the ideas, and Ernie pretty much does the designing of the beer. I tell him how it should taste and all that, and he creates the recipe. We test brew it and then do it in a larger batch.
Okay.
Now, is there any that's offered like overseas that may not be offered over here?
No, just the opposite. There's more offered here than overseas.
Oh, okay.
Smaller brand product. We like three brands over there.
Okay. But yet,
you doesn't mean we'll change later on, but we're just kind of conservative over there.
Okay. Okay. Now, you mentioned science with Eureka. You have a very vast background in science. So did that kind of inspire you to brewing beer, or was it just something, you know, just totally different?
No, I guess it was. One, I always liked beer. And a college student doesn't drink beer, of course.
Right.
So I was fascinated with it when I moved to Geneva, Switzerland, to do a postdoc in the University of Geneva in the Department of Molecular Biology. I just fell in love with the beer culture in Europe. I had several I call NREs, near religious experiences, and with beer. One, my friend Rolf, a scientist, a theoretical mathematician at CERN, we drove to his house in Mainz in Germany. And he's driving like a crazy person on the auto route, and I was scared and nervous about how fast he was driving, and he suggested that we go stop into Old Town Mainz and have a beer before we reach his house. I said, yeah, good idea. And that was probably the biggest moment I used to get into the beer business. We waited in a small cafe with a circular bar, and we were at a stand-up table. There's only like five people in the place.
Okay.
It was a quiet Wednesday evening. And we ordered beer, and we're waiting. I could see the guy pour the beer. It would be my first draft beer in Germany. I just arrived like several months earlier to Switzerland.
Okay.
And I looked at Rolf. I said, Rolf, where's the beer? And the guy, I saw him pour the beer. And he said, be patient. So we're talking, a couple more minutes go by, and I turn to Rolf and I said, Rolf, where's the beer? He said to me, and I'll never forget this. He said, be patient. Good things take time. It will come.
Okay.
So just after he said that, the person comes with on a platter these two real tall Pilsner glasses, a little paper collar at the base. The foam is running down the sides, and the bead is going up the glass, and I'm going, wow.
Yeah,
I had it. I sipped my first beer, first draft beer out of a German pub, and I went, "Wow, that was phenomenal."
I can only imagine. Yeah.
And something clicked in my head, and I said, "You know, I work my ass off in science 7 days a week. Why don't I work and have fun too?"
Yes.
Work a little bit less and have fun. And I said, maybe there's a way I can get into the beer business. So over time, for the next that was next 10 years, I studied beer, I went to beer congresses, I started home brewing, I took it very seriously.
Yeah.
And that led me to trying to build a brewery in Belgium.
Okay. Well, it definitely, I think, paid off, and just because the products that you create are amazing. I remember I know I've tried the Raven. I know I've tried Annabelle Lee. I'm trying to think of the other ones I've tried. I think the Annabelle Lee was one of my favorites. That was the one that I was like, I like this a lot. Absolutely.
You'll like Lenore too. Sure.
I can't wait to try that one. I also can't wait to try the one with the oyster, just that the saltiness almost reminds me of a Gosa, like it has that salty kind of flavor in a way. So
yeah,
that will be interesting. So, like, speaking of Poe, because we always love to talk Poe. So you grew up in Baltimore, surrounded by Poe everywhere, or maybe not as much as there is now, but with the Ravens and everything. And so, or the football team. So what, like, hooked you on Poe? Was it when you were younger in school, or was it more when you grew up and became an adult?
Yeah, my first experience with Poe was my brother and I went to the cinema, excuse me, on a Saturday afternoon, and we watched the movie Premature Burial, and a Poe story, an adaptation of Edgar Allan Poe's Premature Burial, and what really left an impression on me was that the lead actor, lead figure in the story, he suffers from catalepsy, where he can just fall asleep without any warning, and to the point where he's almost dead. And at one time, he always feared that he will die, or he will go into this trance and be buried alive. And in this movie, this happens. And what I saw sitting up in the second or third row, looking way up like that, was the person being lowered into the grave. He has a glass window, and you see through his eyes the people up top being, praying and all that. And then his eyes open up. You see his eyes open up. He realizes he's in a coffin. He's being buried alive, which he always feared. And next thing you see is the dirt being shoveled on top of the coffin. Through his eyes, you see the dirt coming over. And I went, that freaked me out so much as a kid. So I became a Poe fan ever since.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. Well, do you have a favorite Poe story and or poem? I mean, a lot of people have both, like a favorite of each.
Yeah, I think The Raven probably is my favorite poem. I think Predicament may be my favorite story. I just love the whole concept of the clock in the hand.
Yeah, it's like you see it coming, but you hope it won't. And then it's like, ah.
Just headless.
Oh, I
And
know.
Poe is so good at drawing you in and making you want more no matter what it is. And it's like, is it really going to be? Is it not? It's kind of like with the pendulum. It's like swinging, and you're like, is he going to die? Is he not? It and it's great that you brought in Poe to another creative work with your beer, because creating your beer is kind of like telling its own story. So that in itself is another homage to, Poe's influence, in my opinion. So.
Oh yeah, Poe and culture is everywhere, all over the world. I mean,
Absolutely,
I don't think
absolutely.
there's another literary figure that has so much current day culture
I,
revolved around him or her.
I would totally agree with that. I mean, you see some Shakespeare things here and there, but as I am like constantly people, friends of mine and people that I know and that are more acquaintances and things like that, they will send me like through Facebook Messenger, have you seen this meme? Have you seen this cartoon? And it's exciting. It's exciting seeing those things, come through. And so.
It could be subtle. It could be like a small picture of Poe behind Sgt. Pepper's album of the Beatles, sitting there with Bob Dylan over there and Poe over here, for example. And little just small things is referenced all over the place.
Oh, I know. It's just it's unreal of how much pop culture is influenced by Poe. So, you had said you just got back from the Adirondack. I'm not talking correctly today. Adirondack Mountains. And I think what you said, one of your goals is to hike all of them. So how many have you done so far?
Well, these are, I'm referencing the High Peaks. There's many
okay.
more.
Yeah, that's right. Yes.
And there are 46 of them. Right. And I think I'm at 38 or 39.
Wow.
Yeah. And they're getting harder because they're further in the forest. Most people don't realize the Adirondacks is the biggest park in America.
Okay.
It's mm-hmm. the largest park in America, mm-hmm. In the lower 48, bigger than any federal or state parks. So
wow.
you've got to go pretty far into the Adirondacks to reach some of these peaks. And so they're overnight stays, camping, mm-hmm. and all that. They're pretty strenuous, particularly as I'm getting older. They're not getting easier, that's for sure.
Okay. Oh, I can't even imagine. Oh, my goodness.
But I bet they're still beautiful.
Oh, yeah.
They're lovely. Absolutely lovely.
Jeannie, what other questions did you have?
Well, I was thinking about the artwork that's on your beer cans and stuff like that. Who does the inspiration, or who do you have that does the art illustrations for what you come up with?
Yeah, that's a story in itself. when we built the new brewery in 2012, we wanted to launch new brands. And I was sitting in my kitchen table on the internet, and I was just surfing around, and up came Flying Dog Brewery out of Frederick, Maryland. And Flying Dog has Ralph Steadman, very, very well-known artist, doing their mm-hmm. labels. I said to myself, I wish I knew somebody as talented as Ralph Steadman mm-hmm. who could draw my labels. And all of a sudden I said, I know that person. I just met him a year before. I used to be president of the Maryland Apple Corps, the Apple Club, Apple
oh.
Computer Club.
Okay.
And I invited this cartoonist to come in and, you know, display his skills. Mm-hmm. And because he's an Apple, he uses Apple computers and all that stuff. But he is the political cartoonist for the Baltimore Sun and the first oh. resident cartoonist for The Economist magazine out of London. So
wow.
he is a well-known worldwide cartoonist.
Mm-hmm.
And his name is Kevin Gallagher, Cal. And we became friends, and I called Kevin. And I said, Kevin, would you like to do our labels? He said, no, it's 2012. The Republican Democratic conventions are coming up. I'll be really busy with that. Call me in November. I said, no, I can't do that. I waited a couple of days. I called him again. I said to him, well, you know, this is a Baltimore thing, and I don't have much time. And he,
yeah.
again, declined the offer. He said, call me after the conventions. And then I said to him, do you know that Ralph Steadman does Flying Dog labels? He goes, Ralph? Ralph does Flying Dog beer labels? I know Ralph for the past 30 years. He goes, yeah, if Ralph can do labels, I'll do labels. Let's meet. Just like that. So we met next week. And then a week later, he started bringing preliminary sketches of
mm-hmm.
Poe. And eventually the one you see there, the two-fisted Poe,
yeah.
with
mm-hmm.
the enlarged forehead, that was a trick of his. He said, every cartoon character needs something to stand out. It could be
yeah.
the hair, it could be the head, it could be the nose, whatever it may be. So he
yeah.
chose the forehead because he's an academic person, Poe.
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't make him macabre. He didn't make him goofy, funny. He made him
yeah.
somewhere in between.
Yeah.
A little mysterious, as you can see.
Mm-hmm.
So that was Cal's idea.
Yeah. I love your logo. And I love, especially like with this one that's on Jeannie's profile right now,
mm-hmm.
the smirk, the little smirk that he has on
yeah,
his face. That is fantastic.
So you finally got him to do what you wanted because you made it a competition type of thing, or you just kind of like said, hey, he does it for this, so why can't you do it for me?
Yeah, basically that. He's,
yeah.
you know, I just said he does, Ralph does Flying Dogs, so then he goes, wow, okay, I'll do it. And then I was surprised, all of a sudden he found time. He didn't
hey,
have time before, but he found time.
That's
that
great.
Well, it's very nice. He does a wonderful job, and it's very
yeah.
unique. So I think it fits very well with everything that you've brought out. Like you showed the can a minute ago with the oyster, and I'd be like, oh wow, that would draw me in, I think, more than the beer would at first, because I'm visual.
It so does. We get cool. We get a lot of emails saying, oh, I purchased the beer because of the artwork. It's phenomenal.
Yeah.
And oh, by the way, the beer is good too. So the art does attract people to the brand.
Absolutely. And if you love Poe, this is just, to me, a really great rendition of him. Like you said, it's not silly, goofy. It's not too serious. It's just, it's at the right place that he should be. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Wonderful.
We have, I don't know if you can see, I brought the 20th anniversary.
Oh, nice.
And you can see there are party balloons above the...
Yes, I can see them.
The Buster Palace.
Yep.
And you probably can't, you probably can't see it, but what in the back, I asked Cal if he can make a collage of all the previous five Raven labels. So this is probably the first, as far as I know, the first beer label ever using a collage in the background of all the previous Raven Lager labels.
That's cool. Previous
brand labels. So it's pretty unique. Yeah.
That is really cool.
Right.
Oh, yeah, that is really cool. Did you bring any of the other ones to show, or did you just bring a few things?
Oh, well, yeah, I brought a few.
We love show and tell.
All right. We'll start from the beginning. Here's our first. It's basically nice. Clip art bird. That's the very first one we did back in 1998.
Okay.
A few years later, I took a photo of Poe's gravestone.
Yes.
In the back, in the, behind Westminster Church.
Mm-hmm.
And we put another raven, different raven on it.
Mm-hmm. That's nice.
And then we made the raven more raven-like.
Okay.
And we put the bird with flying wings. And do I have I don't have a raven can.
Okay.
But, you know, and here's our cast. The raven is the same thing. What's interesting is that Poe holds the glass, the style of glass that represents the beer inside the can. So here he's holding a tumbler for a double bock, a heavy beer.
Okay.
Of course, he's holding a standard shaker glass for a stout.
Mm-hmm.
With the lager, he holds a lager glass.
Okay.
And I only brought a telltale heart. Oh, and Telltale Heart, he holds a standard glass. But to the right and left of Poe are symbols of the story. Here you got the floorboards, the hammer, and the vulture eye.
Okay, yes. Oh, that is so neat.
And of course, with the cask, for the cask of Amontillado, you've got the mortar, the bricks and mortar.
Yeah. I love the attention to detail and all those little nuances. Yeah.
And
amazing.
Here is the Imp in the Madhouse Oyster Stout.
Imp
dangling off of the, off the old oyster.
That is really cool.
it's like you get a drink and a story too.
Yeah, I tell people tell me that they sit at our. Sit at a bar and read our labels or cans, and we have that's one of Cal's. It's our coasters.
Oh, I like those. Yes, those are really.
And you can see it's quite unique. Like,
yeah.
And then my daughter did the back drawing, and I have here a line from Poe. And people sit there at a bar and turn the coaster around as they read it.
Mm-hmm.
It's the one with filled with cream and amber. I will drain that glass again. I don't know if you know that one, that line.
Yeah.
So that's the one that's written on the back.
I really like that.
and what also we're unique in because I think we're the only brewery anywhere that has unique bottle caps for every brand. You can see.
Oh, nice.
That's Annabelle Lee. He holds the glass. He holds a Belgian wit style glass. With
okay.
The beer.
Uh-huh.
Here's our seasonal for seasonal beers. This is
Okay.
a generic cap.
Okay.
And here is a Pendulum Pilsner.
Okay.
Using a
Yes.
Pilsner glass.
Yeah.
So every beer has its own
Yeah. And I think,
qualifier.
I don't know which one this
That's the cask,
is.
double
Okay.
barrel.
That is the cask.
That's
Okay.
the purple one,
It,
yeah.
yeah. I, cause I, when I bought these at the Po Fest, I think I might have bought them the very first year of the Po Fest.
Oh.
I was like trying to choose a color, and I was like, what color do I wear mostly with Po stuff? And I'm like, purple. And so that's why I chose this. So
Excellent.
it's very branding, and that's what I like about it, because you have things that you can enjoy, because not just the beer, but you enjoy Poe and stories and everything else. And I think that's just great that you are making him still live in the heart of people who
Yeah.
enjoy drinking,
And the
you know.
stomachs, and the stomachs.
Yeah. And their stomachs.
What makes people
Now,
happy?
speaking of Po Fest, I know you are a sponsor again this year, isn't that correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Cool. How many years have you been a sponsor for the International Po Fest now?
Oh, as long as it has been in existence, I think 2018 we started.
Really cool.
I'm also a board member of the Po House and Museum in
Oh,
Baltimore.
very nice. Very
Oh, that's
nice.
good enough.
I feel obligated to do so, but it's fun anyway.
Oh, absolutely. That would be. And so what other events do you guys like go to or sponsor and things like that?
Well, pre-COVID, we did a lot. We did something like 93 events a year.
Wow. Oh,
It's like
wow.
over 20% of the days of the year we're doing some kind of event. It could be
Okay.
a pint night, a bar night, a restaurant, beer dinner. It could be a festival, a beer festival. It could be anything, you
Okay.
know. We do a lot of sponsoring or donations to charitable events. We focus on health care, homelessness, and environment, and the
That's
arts.
okay.
Oh,
That's
wonderful.
fantastic. Because I think you guys are also, I think, a sponsor for the National Poe Theater
Yes,
as
the
well.
Atlantic
Yes.
Grand Pope
Okay.
Theater,
Yeah.
right.
Those guys are great. Alex is a
Alex.
fantastic guy.
Oh, good.
Yes.
Yeah, yes.
Yeah, he's been on the show too.
Oh, has he? Ah, you never
Yeah.
told me. I didn't realize that.
Yeah, and monthly we do we call it our unbook club called Poe Unplugged, and we were doing El Dorado. We recorded that last night, and he sent us their adaptation of El Dorado, and so we were able to share that with everybody. And so, because it's great, it's really good.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
I write short stories. I'm writing my autobiography. I've been taking a class since 2021, I think I started.
Okay.
And I also write short stories. I've written several short Poe stories adaptations.
Oh,
So
nice. Okay.
I'm
Are
really
you?
getting into it. I've never written, being in science, I've always written or I wrote about beer or science. I've never written fiction before. And I'm
Okay.
really like
That,
it.
yeah. Are you planning on publishing like
I
your
hope
collection?
so.
That,
Yeah.
oh, I will look forward to that. That's going to be great. That will be really cool. Yeah, Jeannie and I dabble at poetry and short stories as well, and we're eventually going to put something together and publish. It's just
Yeah.
finding the time.
I haven't done poetry yet, but short stories I like.
Yeah,
Nice.
they're fun because they can go so many different ways. You
Sure.
know, if you plan it out, or if you just, you know, kind of have that discovery and you just start writing and just have an idea. And yeah, they are a lot of fun to write, definitely. Trying to think of anything else. I was writing down notes. One other thing that I read that you did, you had a radio show for a while.
Oh, yeah. I did.
Yeah, was that fun?
Yeah, that was in Luxembourg.
Okay.
I I went to this radio station to be interviewed because we were doing Beer Around the World, the beer club in Luxembourg. That's where we're based. So I got invited to be interviewed on a radio. And they then, I don't know how the conversation got started, but they asked me if I wanted to do a show myself.
Okay.
Because it's an English-speaking station in Luxembourg.
Oh, they brought nice.
Throughout Luxembourg into France, Germany, and Holland. And I said, yeah, I've never done this before. I guess we'll teach you all the little tricks and all that.
Mm-hmm.
And she come up with an idea. So I came up with jazz and beer. Play jazz music.
Okay.
And between songs, talk about beer.
That's
so
cool.
At the time, yeah. So at the time, I was writing an insert, a pamphlet called Beer Sips, every month for our beer club,
mm-hmm.
which I had, did you know, facts about beer, short stories about beer. So I could use my beer sips. And I also wrote for the American Brewer and beer and other beer magazines.
Mm-hmm.
So I had stories. I had all this information about beer. I would sit it next to me. And as the song played, I prepared what to talk about between the songs.
Okay.
It was an hour show once a week. Beer and jazz. So that's what I did.
Oh, that just sounds like so much fun.
Yeah. And it's interesting is that I was in Radio Luxembourg, very famous radio station, which was taken over by the Nazis in Second World War to use as propaganda. Once mm-hmm. the Battle of the Bulge was over and the Allies took over Luxembourg, which is in the Ardennes, mm-hmm. They took over the radio station and it became part of the American armed forces and of all the allies. It was also the same station that influenced pirate radio. If you've ever heard of Radio Caroline,
okay.
which was the original pirate radio out in the Atlantic, because in Britain, they only mm-hmm. had one radio station that played rock music.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the BBC, and it was pretty bad music, apparently, and only a few hours a day.
Yeah.
And the people listened to Radio Luxembourg, which played rock music. But they had other issues, so Radio Caroline was a result of the fact that Radio Luxembourg would not play all... They were into, what's that expression, peyote?
Yeah.
Where they pay people to play certain music.
Yes, yes.
So they only played certain music from certain companies that produce right. it, big label ones.
Yeah.
And so Radio Caroline resulted because Radio Luxembourg refused to play other music.
Okay.
So that's how pirate radio started in England, off
that's
the shore.
That's fascinating.
Yeah.
Oh,
so
wow.
I was a little bit of history there, I guess.
Yeah. Oh no, we love history. I still teach and I teach English, but I've taught history and mm-hmm. Jeannie, I'll let you tell a little bit about you.
Yeah, I've taught all four of the main subjects. And my last mm-hmm. before I had to retire, I was American history and science, which is very two that don't usually go together because usually it's math
right.
and science together
yes.
or English
yeah.
and history. So it was very interesting that I could bring the science to the history and the history to the science.
Yeah.
And you were talking about the pirate radio. And I remember watching a movie that was made that was about that. And it's been
yep.
years since I've seen it. But when you said that, I went, oh, wow. So that is very cool that I could that I remembered that. But
yeah, there was a big Hollywood movie.
Yeah.
On.
Okay. It was just amazing. And, you know, radio being the influence back in those days,
mm-hmm.
but you having a show that was designed for jazz and beer, which to me, jazz is very much goes very well with beer.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of the, well, you know, just like certain cocktails, you think about certain, like martinis. When you think about martinis, you don't think about like hard rock, heavy metal. So, yeah.
Point.
So
yep.
it's very interesting that you had that opportunity not only to be a part of history, but to have that type of an influence
yeah.
on mm-hmm. the radio station. So that's very cool.
Yeah. Thank you. If you like history, Radio Caroline was named after Caroline Kennedy, John F. Kennedy's daughter. The guy was a Kennedy fan who started the pirate radio.
It's wonderful how those ties pop in together, so that's great.
Absolutely. And that's kind of what we find with Poe. All these, we look for connections everywhere. Like when my husband and I travel, we always try to find some kind of Poe connection, even if it's, several degrees away from him and his works and things like that. And it's fascinating what you find out there and that exists.
A lot of Poe pubs all over the country. Michigan, Florida, North Carolina, South Carolina, Arizona.
Oh, I
They're
know.
everywhere.
Yeah, they are.
Whiskey
And
pubs.
my husband and I are traveling in for Thanksgiving to like right around Asheville, North Carolina. And so we're going to go to Hendersonville and go to that
Hendersonville.
Poe pub. Yeah, so
Been
I'm
there.
excited about that.
Yeah. I know the people well.
Oh,
They're good
great.
people.
Okay. Awesome. Jeannie, can you think of
Well,
any other things you want to know?
no, he has covered very well everything, and I just want to say thank you for keeping Poe alive. And even though that most people don't think, well, one of the things that we were talking about, one of the myths that surround Poe's death is everybody thinks he, was an alcoholic and he died from that and stuff. But that's just one of those myths that has percolated over the years. But having such an impact and being involved with the arts, like you said, you're supportive of the arts of everything in Baltimore. So I would like to say just thank you for being a part of that and continuing the Poe legacy.
Yes,
You're welcome. Thank
absolutely.
you. Glad to be on.
Stephen,
Thank you for
this has
joining us.
been awesome speaking with you. I know I've talked to you several years off and on at the Poe Fest and everything. I know my husband really enjoys talking with you as well.
Oh, good.
And so it was like we should have already had you on the podcast, and or we call it the Pocast. And we're so glad you were able to meet with us today. This has been
Me
great.
too. You're
All
welcome.
right.
Glad to be here.
Thank you.
Too.
Well, Jeannie, I guess on that note,
We are
we're
Poe.
out.